Well, we're blessed here with momentum. We're blessed with momentum, which is all important, which is the Dharma. Dharma is really momentum towards realization, which could be many labels could be used. You could say realization of no momentum, realization of no realization, actually. There's no realizer and no realization. So it's momentum towards no momentum, no realization, which is tough because we've been working on realization momentum for so long, trying to get the I to be enlightened, the imaginary I. We're trying to get all these techniques, hoping that it will cause an I to be created, a singular illusion created, which will never happen. So it's really difficult for us to back off all our efforts, isn't it? Reality doesn't require any efforts on our part to engineer it or to establish it. Natural presence, spontaneous, natural, inherent presence, no effort at all on our part to establish it, to maintain it, to engineer it, to structure it. Nothing is needed in that regard at all from us. So we have momentum, which is all important. So I place so much emphasis on momentum. How to generate momentum and how to sustain momentum is so important. How to keep the path smooth so you continuously have momentum. So today is Christmas Day, and so I've powered through it with tremendous momentum. By not by engineering it, but by skillful means and heads up, like advanced weather forecaster. If you get advanced forecast, say it's going to be like this coming up in a while, then you can get things prepared properly. Whereas if you don't, it may hit you unexpected. So I'm able to get advanced warnings about what's coming from spiritual intuition, from the Holy Spirit, from the Dharma kings, and therefore, I put faith in this, and then I act as if this is going to be so. So I prepare, just like if a hurricane was coming in. You got advance notice. You'd be able to do everything you need to do, your store, your house, help others, and get a hotel, some other city, some other state, get out of state, be there, and then terrible hurricane comes and all the damage, but you come back and your house is fine, everything's fine. You did what you're supposed to do through advance warning. Really important to have advance warning. So I get advance warning of what's to come. I act on it. I know I needed to power through this time, so I acted upon that properly. Was asked, would you like to do an intensive for the next 2 months? And I said, well, that's a good way to keep momentum going, isn't it? Momentum's all important. You cannot let your momentum stall out. That leads to panic and fixation and mental illness, actually. And really, the samsaric realms, the hell realms, the mayic realms, are alternate between brutality and mental illness. That's all. That's the options you have. When we're trying to establish a separate I, create a new creation, we end up either in a very brutal state of mind or a very mentally ill state of mind, and we cycle just between those two, basically, in different realms, until we give up the quest, give up the search for an I, for a separate self, for a singular illusion. We give up that quest, and then both brutality and mental illness, fall away, and we realize, none of it ever actually touched what I am at all. It was just illusions touching other illusions. But what I am is pristine, untouched, untouched, totally untouched. So we're going towards that goal. And we need momentum so we don't fall back into either mental illness or brutality. Right now, the world is a very brutal place. It's a place of mixed brutality and mixed mental illness, which is why it's kind of a weird world right now. And they're battling one another. For instance, the conservatives are characterized more by brutality, okay? And the liberals are characterized more by mental illness. That's exactly how things played out in like the United States election. Trump, for instance, is characterized by sort of a brutal, forceful personality. And Hillary Clinton was characterized by a mentally ill personality. And So you have these two camps of brutality and mental illness fighting one another for, you know, what's the best way to stabilize instability? And of course, the answer is neither. And the third option is the Dharma. So both brutality and mental illness are simply two sides of one coin of non-dharmic culture. Non-dharmic culture. The Dharma, spiritual momentum, okay, towards realization of no realization, no realizer, no realization, no teacher, no student, no teaching. So we have the options really between a dharmic culture and a non-dharmic culture. So you're either dharmic or non-dharmic, right? It's one of the two. And the worst mistake of all is what happens is that the brutal, mentally ill cultures, they want to destroy the Dharma. They want to get rid of it totally. But they say, how can we do this? And they say, well, let's first align with it and pretend that we're interested in it. And what they do is they say, well, we can blend the two. You know, we can blend both truth and lies. And of course, ultimately, as you go down that path, you end up decimating the Dharma. At least you believe you have. Which leads to mental illness or brutality. So it's just, you go around in circles. But the idea of combining, you know, integrating dharmic culture and non-dharmic culture is the greatest mistake of all. And this is where many of the so-called do-gooders, this is what Jesus targeted and continues to target. And he's right on the mark about this. When he came back in biblical times a couple thousand years ago, who did he point out are the real troublemakers? The self-righteous, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, those who said, no, we can, you know, combine truth and lies, and we have all these rituals, we'll sacrifice this, and that'll take care of the problem. There's some problem there, but let's sacrifice an animal, let's sacrifice something, and then, quote-unquote, God will be happy. In other words, their inner conflict, they claim that God's unhappy with them. No, it's just just because what they're doing doesn't work. That's the problem, not because God's angry at them. And they think, well, we can, you know, something has to die. You know, something's got to mean spirit has to die in order for us to be happy. Well, spirit can't die. The very nature of spirit is happiness. It's only when our attention is not recognizing God, intrinsic spaciousness, that we have all these troubles. It's still there. It's still there, but our attention is furiously trying to knot itself all up in many directions. So, Jesus pointed out that the worst of the worst are these self-righteous ones who wrap non-dharmic culture in all sorts of high-sounding rhetoric and rituals and all this kind of stuff. We were in church, Catholic Church, yesterday, and last couple of weeks, actually, and the priest giving the homily says, you know, when Jesus was born, nobody recognized him. Finally, a shepherd boy recognized him, but he says, isn't that the truth that so many just don't recognize Jesus at all, and these self-righteous ones? And the homily the week before that was about how the self-righteous ones, you know, rejected Jesus, and I realized so clearly the church is exactly what Jesus was talking about. They're the ones that don't recognize Jesus, and they're the ones who are wrapped in these robes of righteous piety and charity and all the stuff. Meanwhile, calling Jesus a liar, totally rejecting Jesus. So a non-dharmic culture totally rejects the Dharma. So, I mean, where's the compromise? How do you mix the two up? They're mutual opposites, total mutual opposites. There is no way to combine the two. But what the non-dharmic culture does in an attempt to drag the Dharma down, destroy it, tries to say, no, we're aligned with you. You don't know, we can make a deal. Let's compromise. Let's find a compromise. And this is what Jesus pointed out is the most severe trouble of all. Most severe trouble of all. And this is what we have right now in this world, is the non-dharmic culture is trying to expropriate as much of the Dharma as it can, the labels, the rhetoric, various stuff, wrap itself up in these robes of piety, put the whipped cream of self-righteousness on the cake of non-dharmic culture, and then claim that's it, we've got it. But when you claim that's it and you've got it, this completely excludes true dharmic culture, doesn't it? Yeah, it does. It certainly does. So they're really trying to exclude true dharmic culture by offering a counterfeit and saying the counterfeit is it, therefore this dharmic culture must be the counterfeit. So it's this clever game of gradually trying to flip the script on dharmic culture and claim that it's the counterfeit. This is what the world is all about at this point in time. Absolutely it is. So, but we can do something about it as far as our own sanity, right? It's sticking with dharmic culture. Is you skillful beings, attention, use so much to keep your momentum going towards recognition, right? Which certainly I'm doing. Every day, like last couple of mornings, I was able to sleep in, so I was able to really work on clarity. And lying there in bed, I wake up early at 5 in the morning, and I work at it maybe till 9 or 10 o'clock. And just tremendous clarity has been opening up. Just, you know, obvious, super dharmic recognitions. Guru type of recognitions. I just say, wow, okay. Wow, I just wow it. Which is the one label that we allow, so to speak, to label. And as we see the truth, we the only label we apply is wow. This is the great technique that Ram Maharshi, for instance, the gurus know this, that use one label to block out all the others. And then ultimately that one label will go to. Ramana uses the analogy of using a stick to stir a fire to make sure it all burns. But then ultimately, as that stick that you're using to make sure all the other log, you know, kindling and sticks burn, that one stick also gets burned too, doesn't it? And then they're all gone. That is the way. That's the way. That's the great, great way. And it's true. It's true. We're just using wow as, instead of Ramana used I. I couldn't quite resonate with that. And then I had this dream, Ramana reassure me that you do what you're doing, and that's just as good. It's the same thing. You don't have to use the I. You don't have to do it exactly. Say the I. Wow. Works just as well. It works just as well, if not better. You know, but it was just as well. Actually, it depends on what you feel comfortable with. It's a convention that we use here, and conventions, of course, lead to shorthand, which needs to brisk gradualism, which leads to smooth path, rapid progress, ultimately liberation. Okay, that's what it's all about. That's what the Dharma is all about, is we have to establish some conventions. Intensives are designed to establish conventions. That's the most difficult thing there is. If you pray that for conventions and habits in your life. And when you get, you know, we pray like we ask help. We don't know how the help's going to come. What's it going to be like? But then you may discover after you pray at some moment, you'll suddenly feel kind of inspired to start a new habit. This happened to me today. I had this, I've had this Pilates ball. I actually bought it for a gift and they couldn't use it. So it's been hanging out in the room here. And I said, what the heck do you use this for? I don't understand this. I've never done Pilates. Pilates, what is that? I still don't know, but I actually started using it today. I said, I'm just going to sit on this thing and see what happens. And I said, oh, I can pivot. And I'm like, oh, it gets my core. And like, oh, I can do this. I can do that. And it's a core. It really helps your core exercise. It's great for that. So I started that today, and that's after tremendous prayers both last night and today, just because we live in such a brutally mentally ill culture. It's just insane, absolutely insane. And I said, I just can't take it anymore. You know, I need help. It's just, I feel so isolated trying to, you know, keep the flow of the Dharma going in the world where, you know, it's just people are having such a difficult time with it. So, you know, I can get down, you know, and I have to bounce back somehow. And so what did I get? I got the inspiration. So I'm going to do this. So I pumped it up. It was flat. A lot of my stuff has been flat. Like this ball was flat. I have a balance ball, and I also have a Bosu ball. It's a type of balance ball too. And it's a half ball with a flat base. All of those, I pumped them all up last couple days. So, you know, they're ready to go. And then I actually started using them. So I started a new workout regimen at a higher level today, Christmas Day. This is definitely in response to my prayers, okay? That's the most valuable, is your habits and your conventions. And it's the most difficult. Establishing conventions and habits is the most difficult thing you'll ever do, because you'll procrastinate So if you... whenever you are able to start in on a new training program, a new habits, and that means you're really inspired and you're really blessed. That means you've been praying to the Dharma Kings and they're answering your prayers. That's what you should look for, actually. I just have a whole new kick going on just starting today. I'm wearing swimming trunks. I just some friends came over and they're building a swimming pool and they said, "Hey, when we get the pool done, you have to come over and swim." You know, and it's like so I put on swimming trunks. I said, "Hey, you know, it has a different reason to, actually. I was going to go to the water and but." It's like, oh, I feel comfortable in that. It's like a whole different thing. My whole style has changed. Suddenly, it's just there's a different feel, different vibe. It just right away just flipped. At once now that Christmas is kind of over, I can feel there's something new coming. There's something great coming. And so I've started back in with a training program. I never let it slip away entirely. Yes, I had a bad knee injury that. It's just it was a sort of a chronic, maybe overdoing things. I had, you know, maybe some tears in there. It was just sort of the weak, but really, it was, of course, it's psychosomatic. Everything is. It came, well, I had this experience 2 days ago where I suddenly lost my equilibrium and I tried to get up and I fall to the right and then I tried to go, I fall to the left. I had no stability. I kept falling either to the right or the left. I said, wow. Never felt this way before. What is this? And inwardly, I was very nervous, just feeling very unstable. And I realized yesterday, I said, oh, I know what that is. This is the polarity conflict in the world, how we're going to be pushed and pulled from two different directions, and it's just going to cause us to collapse. And if you're pushed and pulled between brutality and mental illness, you know, eventually the Dharma is going to collapse, right? So, for over a year now, about for almost 16 months, I was told I had to get in great shape. I had to get in great shape, especially with, you know, the balance, agility, strength, and there's one other one, but flexibility. Okay, so balance, agility, flexibility, strength. Balance, agility, flexibility, strength. The purpose of that is to at least have some feeling in your body, but body mind, you might say, this is a feeling that you're kind of like a palm tree. You can bend with the wind. I use the palm tree as an analogy. I love palm trees because the wind, they just kind of sway gracefully like this, you know. And no matter what the wind does, the wind cannot knock a palm tree down, basically. It's pretty difficult, isn't it? It really is. They're deep-rooted, and they're slender, the wind cuts through them, the top is pretty light, it's not too heavy, and it just sways. Just, even hurricanes, you know, they can handle hurricanes, everything. So we need to be like a palm tree. We need to be like a palm tree. We need to be very flexible. We need to be strong. They're strong. They're agile in the way that they move. They're agile and balance. They seem to always recover their balance. They don't topple over. They don't topple over. So they can handle a severe storm. So we need our fitness to reflect like a palm tree. So I have been doing this. I have been doing this, and then the knee thing, you know, slowed me down as I was getting a little. I was getting kind of scared, like maybe I'm getting too confident, too agile, too much. I just for some reason, you know, the whole intensity of the world now brought about me slamming on the brakes, and so I couldn't really do the kind of fitness that I was doing before. I was really feeling terrific before, just, you know, prancing in circles on my toes and leaping here and leaping there, almost like parkour-like ability. And I had to back off of that. Maybe it was going a little too fast. I felt maybe it was going too fast. I got scared. I said, "Wow, I'm almost like I can do parkour." Oh, I don't know if I should do that. You know, I started getting nervous. So the knee problem took care of that for a while, and I've been rehabbing it, and now I'm starting to get back to a workout program, which we'll see what I can do to help you out with this. But it's something you can do. Food and exercise is something you can pretty easily control, actually. It seems more difficult to control your thoughts and your mind, right? Your attention. So I highly advise, of course, that this training and it's a convention that we have. Convention, establishing conventions leads to shorthand, means to quick recognitions. It's brisk, at least a briskness, which is all important. All important. Brisk gradual brisk, but briskly, brisk gradualism, conventions, shorthand, brisk gradualism, okay? Full stop in the wow, success. Without conventions, we just struggle, 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 struggle. There's no shorthand. We can't just talk about stuff. I say, yeah, BOSU ball, do a little BOSU ball this way, and you say, oh, I get it. If you know what a BOSU ball is or a balance ball, and say, okay, we're going to do this, we're going to do sets of this, and you know why. Say, okay, this is helping us be like a palm tree. So we need to work out in this way. We know the exercises we do. And dun, 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 the comprehension is quick. And then you gradually do it every day, but you're briskly making success. It's the same way in school and business and any walk of life. There's all this shorthand, which cut, you know, saves you so much time instead of laboriously trying to explain everything, the conventions over every single time, having to explain why the convention, what is the convention. Of course, that's like retarded, right? I mean, you cannot, that retards progress to the point where it stalls out. So you can't, we cannot have that. We cannot have that. In an intensive, we try to establish conventions. So coming out of the intensive, we can use the conventions, and then you can really go. You can handle your business if you understand certain basic conventions. So this is all important. I have not yet been able to establish conventions here in the world. Keep working at it. If those can just, you know, if you need to pray the Dharma Kings, they'll inspire you and you will see it and say, oh my gosh, this is so important. I need to do this. And that's why you have various religions that are just a set of conventions. And we're working on establishing a new set of conventions here that is very, very intuitive. And certain things are pointed out to us to help us with power through these times that are coming, difficult times. So I said, yes, I will work on this. I will work on this. So to help the Dharma, to help the Dharma keep the momentum going. And everyone has conventions whether they know it or not. And that's called their comfort zone. Why? Because they get it so quickly. Oh, yeah. They get the lingo. They get the talk, the context, everything. They've worked on a set of conventions. So, but this is the hard work. This is the difficult work, is to establish those conventions and habits in your life. But that's the essential work. The intellectual stuff, like reading a book by this so-and-so, that's, anyone could do that. All right, that doesn't necessarily do much for you at all, actually, in terms of the Dharma. There's a million self-help books, a million spiritual books out there. You know, very, very few of them, if any, talk about establishing conventions and habits and actually get you to actually do that. Seriously, it's amazing how the Dharma has fallen so far. The key is your habits and the conventions. And this is what's totally ignored in today's culture. And we think, should we just read a self-help book by somebody or a book by some, you know, non-dual teacher or something? But that's the answer. It's not. Not even remotely the answer. Haven't even begun to do the hard work. Because the polarity is designed to keep your attention from settling. It agitates your attention. See, what we need to do is let our attention settle just down. As it settles down, we just wow the settling. Because as it settles down, we start glimpsing truth. And we just say, oh my gosh, wow. Then we start thinking, well, how do I label this? Just wow is the only label we use. And when we use just that one label, we don't stray from the clarity very far at all. It's right there. That's how every day I'm able to access it now, more and more and more. It's right there. It's just beneath the surface in my case. So I just keep wowing it. That's it. No other label. I refuse to use any other label. This is the secret. This really, just use one label for all the glimpses of clarity you have. Do not try to describe or define it too much. I mean, I have to do some work in explaining a little bit, but what we're really after is the practice. We're not here to write some book that explains reality to you. That's not very dharmic, actually. Real dharma culture is a culture of practice, of conventions and practice. That's true dharmic culture. And the practice can be very simple, like Ramana had, just inquiry of just one label. Use just one label. So as we get used to using just one label for describing reality, the attention can settle off of all other labels, evenly settle off of all other labels. And ultimately, the attention will see, ah, it's labeling that got me into trouble in the first place, didn't it? Labeling creates this contrast of this and not this, subjective, objective duality. And the attention is able to see, you know, what are the key mistakes that it's making? Oh, it's labeling. Contrast. Two illusions. Illusions always arise as duality, each one contrasting with the other. Then we label the differences between the two. And so anyway, you're able to see it. You're able to recognize it inwardly. As our attention settles, this begins to begin to notice this. We say, oh, wow, that's the trouble, huh? Okay. And then so just wow what you see. Just wow what you see. No other label. Refuse any other label. It's easy if you try, if you do it. It's not possible if you don't try or don't do it. So you get those who say, well, I'm not going to do it. I don't want to do it. I'm not going to do it. But how do I, you know, how do I do it? Well, there's no, if you don't want to do it, then no, there's no how will work. No how will work. And if you do want to work it, no how is necessary, really. I mean, it's so simple, right? It's just one label. Wow. So I see this, I see it, I see so much this morning, I said, okay, wow. Wow, 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 wow. Nothing but wow. It's nothing but wow. That's one label, one label. It's so important to accept this practice of just one label. Very abstract, wow, so abstract. Right, just one label, very abstract label, wow. This lets our attention settle off of all other labels, all other contrasts, all which are all dualistic. It settles down off of those, off of that. Okay. So this is the key convention that we have here. It's a super dharmic convention. It's the heart of the Dharma. It's just one label, one reaction. Don't do anything other than just wow it. I use this ball to explain the wow, where there's all these potential labels here, right? You could see all these little, each one of these is like a definition, a label, an expectation, a concept, reaction, you know, this. And yet it's just one ball, isn't it? It's just one ball. So we just call this ball of overall thinking just wow. Just wow. So when I see clarity, I say, okay, this is just one ball. Wow. It's just the wow ball. Okay, it's the wow ball. It's not, well, this is part of the wow ball, this is part of the wow, and this is different than this, and labeling all these little different spikes. We don't label the different spikes at all. We just say this is a wow ball. That's it. Just a wow ball. And we see it just that way. Nothing more than that. It's the doing more than that that leads to the trouble. So the Dharma is all about simplicity. It's not about complexity. It's all about simple practice, not about complex practice. So we just wow and nothing more than wow. Don't even get into any negative condemnations because that seems, well, no, just wow. Nothing else but wow. Don't start thinking, well, I can really defeat the troubles by pointing out how wrong they are and stuff. No, just wow. Don't do neither positive nor negative. Neither positive nor negative. This is the absolute key convention. But we have some others. I've been watching surfing surfing a lot. I've been getting into surf related stuff a lot. Just, I don't know why, I'm paying attention. I'm watching all these surfers and these wave, big wave contests and various contests and stuff. It's like, huh, what am I picking up on? A lot of stuff. When they're, deep in the barrel of like Bonsai Pipeline, which is a great barrel wave, they're not doing a bunch of fancy maneuvers in there. They're just in the wow, right? And poof, they come out like that. So they have to be very, very tucked in and not trying to be all over the place when they're in a tight, big barrel. Like, just like, and they come out. And just, oh, so it's like the wow when we get really barreled by clarity. The wave of clarity. You have to be very focused and say, I'm just, going to be stable in the wow. It's all about stability, right positioning. It just don't try to get fancy. Don't try to get fancy. So I've been watching a lot of surfers. I'm starting to get, more and more informed. It's been a gradual thing over the last couple months, actually. So conventions take a lot of work. I'm very good at this. I pioneer conventions. That's what part of my role is to help the Dharma, flourish. And in order to do that, one has to be have the skill of someone has to establish conventions, and it takes a lot of extra work actually, and it had to be patient at it. Gradually, I was began to sort of sort out the surf scene a little bit. It's not sorted out by any means yet, but it's starting to come into a little better focus, and I'm not trying to know everything about it, but various aspects are emerging that are pretty interesting. And another thing is, all the big waves now don't look, seem so big to me. I remember as a kid looking at the big waves of like Sunset, Waimea Bay, Pipeline in Hawaii. I used to have a poster on my wall of Greg Knoll standing in front of the Sunset, I think. Huh. It just, I mean, massive wave. I couldn't believe it. Of course, it was telephoto lens made it look like awesome. I didn't realize that. But I was always just in awe of big waves. It just seems like the most forceful things in nature, isn't it? These gigantic waves and the people who can ride those waves. I was just dumbfounded by it all. And my whole life, I've been in awe of that. And now, recently, looking, and so this is. What has happened is through familiarity, the shock is wearing off. It's wearing off. It's wearing off. I'm seeing it more the way it is through the modern photography. A lot of GoPro, a lot of surface. The camera work now is so amazing. But you begin to have a different perspective on it all. And now it's not so intimidating or awesome at all. I watched a contest at Waimea Bay, the Eddie Aikau contest. And that's why first time I've ever seen Waimea Bay alive like that. And they're saying, oh, the waves are unbelievable. And I said, ah, yeah, to me it looks like fun. I wish I was out there, kind of feeling. What's the big deal? I mean, yeah, they're big waves, but they're not that scary. So I've really made incredible progress over the last couple of months by going to the ocean and looking at big waves. And just, at first it just scared, intense, very intimidating. Now, it's not as intimidating. A lot of nervousness is gone. Amazing, huh? Just amazing what familiarity can do. But it's stressful, no doubt about it. So we have that convention of familiarity. But anyway, I noticed a surfer. He's the world champion surfer. I kept hearing this name, John John Florence. I said, why is everybody saying John John? He's just a kid. He's like, I don't know how old is he, 22 or 23 or 20. He's young, just early 20s, maybe. If that, I think he's in his 20s, but it could be 21. He's really young. And he's the world champion. And I said, what? I said, this something's cuckoo here. I don't understand this. What's going on? So eventually, I've now started watching his videos. Say, what is this guy? What's going on here? Why is everybody so gaga about him? I thought, nah, this is something weird. Well, I'm starting to find out. I'm starting to find out, and he's quite extraordinary. Yeah, he's the best surfer in the world right now. And there's another young guy, 19-year-old, Kanoya Igarashi from Huntington Beach, California, who's also really, really good. He was in the finals at the Pipeline Masters, and I thought he won it, but he came in second. I felt he should have won it. And I said, these young guys are astonishing. They really are. They're combining skateboard culture and surf culture in terms of the moves that they're doing. So John is just like, just doing these amazing aerial 360s and just come, and it's just, everything he does, you could see, wow, this guy is really great, a really great surfer. And he's still so young, you can hardly believe, is it possible? But it is. So he was on a surfboard when he was like, I think 6 months old. His mom was a surfer. She put him on her surfboard while she was surfing. And he started his own solo surfing at the age of 5 years old. He lived right at the pipeline, right on the beach, house right on the beach there. So he's been surfing these waves, you know, basically his whole life. And he's so confident and relaxed and at home in these huge waves and difficult conditions. It shows. But he also has tremendous balance that he just doesn't seem to get. Nothing gets him off his board, and he's doing these radical maneuvers and going into whitewater, hugely turbulent whitewater. And everyone expects him to fall, and he comes out of it, and everyone goes, "What? How did he do that?" So I started to say, "Okay, I'm starting to watch him now, and just say, huh, this guy's really good." Like I said, it's tough to see a young person so young, and to really accept the fact that they're the best in the world. You know, it's difficult, especially if you're an older person. But even when you're younger, it's hard to believe. But I have enough humility to accept it. You know, it is what it is. He's just a great surfer. Just like Tiger Woods at 19 was a great golfer, the best in the world. It's like, wow. You know, these kids, if they really focus and grow up and they're naturals at it, they can be really something at an early age. Anyway, long story short, this convention is his balance. He just doesn't fall. And I'm saying, how is that possible? He took off on a wave at Waimea Bay, and the wave basically closed out. I mean, so behind him, he had this wall of white wire about 20 feet high. Yeah, it caught up to him, and I said, "Oh my gosh, he's just going to get clobbered," and he disappears, completely disappears. There's spray and foam, and this massive wall of white water, and he's just gone. And then, waiting, and suddenly he just emerges out of this foam ball, and he's still on his board. I said, "What?" Everybody's like cheering, like, "Wow!" And then he goes back into the foam, and emerges again. And I see them do this many times now, as he gets clobbered, and he makes exodus out of waves. He's in like a barrel at Pipeline, and it closes out, and somehow he punches through and makes an exit out of the front of the wave, right through the wall of whitewater and stuff, and doesn't fall. And people are commenting, this guy just has great balance on his board. It's amazing balance. And some of the cutbacks he does, it's just astonishing. And the 360s, he's the master of these insanely great 360s, probably maybe the best in the world, one of the best in the world, of just landing it perfect. I mean, it's just, the talent is astonishing. He's also a skateboarder, so he's able to skateboard really well too. So he's kind of combining skateboarding with surfing. And I just said, wow. We want to be like John, you know. I want to be like John. That's a convention. I want to be like John. And he's a very humble guy. He's just a kid, you know. He's a very young man, and he's just, you know, he's nothing special in terms of his personality or anything. He's just a great surfer. But I said, it's like I thought, hey, we could use this as a convention. We don't want to fall, because the turbulence, the metaphor here is that the world is like this massive wave at Waimea Bay. It closes out. You know, we think we're going to surf it, and suddenly it closes out, meaning the wall collapses in front of us, and there's nowhere to go. There's just whitewater and turbulence everywhere. And it's like, uh-oh. And this is the situation we're going to be faced with in this world. So the whitewater is going to catch up to us, and that's where you find out. I don't know how he does it, to tell you the truth. Everybody would fall under those circumstances. And you saw so many others falling, taking off in those ways. But he doesn't fall. He doesn't fall. Russell Berkey in Australia, young 19-year-old, I think he's 19 now maybe. He's also great at not falling, the two of them. Those are two young surfers that have this incredible stability. It just, no matter what kind of force, he's being buffeted from all directions, and to not fall. You know, it takes there's something there that we can learn from. So I always say that there's someone who's the very best in the world. They're worth looking at. They're worth paying some attention to and saying, what are they doing, actually? What are they doing? There's some sort of stability they have, right? So we can use that as inspiration, saying, I want to surf like John. Now, maybe not in this life. I won't be able to. But I feel like I almost could. I said, hey, you know, as I watch these surfers, these really top surfers, it seems easier to me. I'm noticing, okay, this is what they do. I'm seeing some moves he makes. Now, he's so quick. He stalls out so quickly, and then he adjusts so quickly. The quick little things that he, cat-like stuff that he does, he's on it like in a flash, you know, making adjustments. And it's just so natural to him. But I'm seeing it. I'm seeing it. Saying, wow, we can be more that way, can't we? In terms of our spiritual, in terms of our dharma, we can be on it like John's on a surfboard, and not get knocked off our dharma momentum the way John doesn't get knocked off his board at Waimea, or anywhere else. It seems like. And the way he stays connected with the wave, like Chopu in Tahiti, backside, he's going with his back to the wave. He hooks his, he crouches down, he grabs a rail, the front rail, and then hooks his arm into the wave to stay like hooked into the barrel, and that way he guides him. You know, and he just makes these tremendous waves that way. He does it at Pipeline too. And it's just a beautiful style. You know, he knows how to do everything right, because he spent his whole life there being tutored by, you know, all these great surfers, and he just has all the right moves at just the right time, and he makes it look ridiculously easy. Some of the veterans just say, you know, he makes us all look foolish, you know, like we don't, you know, he's the man out there, and makes us look like boys, but he's young like a boy, but he's the real man out there, and that's true, he is. And I say, holy cow. And the style and the ease that he, you know, when he sees he's got the wave made somehow, then he's just like, ah, you know, like he just sort of stands up like just a walk in the park, you know, and there's like this 20-foot barrel, you know, crashing around him. And just like, oh my gosh, he's so relaxed because he knows he's got it. You know, he knows he's made it. And so he can relax in these ways. Other people are still freaking out, but he's just completely relaxed. Like, ah, no problem. I got this now. I know I've got it. And he takes off. He says, "Okay, I know I got this drop." And he says, "Okay, I know I got this barrel." And they say, "Okay, now I know I can come out of the barrel and finish the wave out." It's just like it just flows easily, you know, for him like that. And say, "Oh, look at that confidence in the face of potential disaster." You know, he's broken his arm, he's broken his leg, he's got a torn ligament in his ankle, I think he broke his back, because he's surfing the pipeline in these waves that slam you onto the reef, you know, rocky bottoms, you know, very dangerous waves. So you know he's been injured, sure, but he's a young guy, he heals up quick. Not so much myself at 60, the knee is taking its time. It really is. But we want to have our balance like John. So as I'm on these balance, I'm doing balance practicing now. I'm saying, hey, I can't fall. I want to be like John. I don't want to fall. I can't fall here. So what do I have to do to not fall? And so I'm starting to learn, like, hey, keep your balance going front to back, shift, keep shifting that way. Lift your foot up. You don't have to balance on 2 feet. I kept trying to be balancing on 2 feet, for instance. And I'd fall. And I said, what's going on? If you start to fall, lift up one foot up and shift your weight forward or something, and then go back to and on the other foot, and you can just be on one foot. Keep your balance going in all different directions as you're moving, and you'll find that your body will stay pretty much stable that way. So I'm starting to find some tricks to balance, which is very, very important for us. Because again, if we have this physical balance in the world, this does help us. It does help us. It's not the only answer by any means, but it helps us. Just like being, you know, good nutrition, being healthy helps us. Having good health helps us. But I've had a cold recently, which is very unusual for me. That just shows how the kind of stress I was under. I've been under just terrible stress, actually. Having to sleep a lot. Having to just really sleep a lot. I'm so exhausted. I feel so run down and tired. And it's because of what's coming in the world. And so also want to work on flexibility more. I haven't quite got that going the way I want it to do, but I'm still working. I'm still there, and this, I just haven't pushed it to a higher level yet. It's you know, it'll come. I'll pray for inspiration it will arrive. It is really stretch flexibility. Really be able to be very flexible in your body and have tremendous balance as well as agility, 360 degree agility, and then strength. I do, for instance, 40 curls with a 30-pound barbell every day. And whenever I go to a gas station, I do push-ups while the vehicle's filling up. And I try to do 40 straight without any rest. Now, that's, you know, that's pretty much standard for me, is 40. And I can do it up to 60. If I kind of rest a little bit as I'm doing it, not so fast, then I can actually get up to 60 right now. So ultimately, my goal is to be able to do 60 straight, and then, you know, go up to there, and maybe someday, who knows. So I'm in continuing the you know, just to keep the upper body, the shoulders, upper body strong virtually every single day. Every single day, I have not slacked off on that. Now I'm doing more stretching and balancing work. So the combination, the flexibility, the balance, the strength, leads to this overall agility. Okay, it leads to overall agility. So the goal, you might say, the three things, the balance, the flexibility work, and the strength work, lead to agility. And agility is just kind of the thing where, like a trail runner, there's all these rocky trails, and they can just go along, and they just seem smoothly go along. Is no matter how uneven the surface they hit, they just smooth out the path, they keep it smooth. This is what we want. No matter how turbulent the world comes, we want our path to remain smooth. Nothing affects us from this way or that way. We just stay with our good habits. Just wow it all. Just wow. The only reaction is the world. Just wow. That's all. Ramana said, ignore the ego in all its activities, meaning ignore the world. Just ignore it, he says. Don't pay any attention to it. Just do your inquiry. Just say, wow, wow. Trump this, wow. Hillary this, wow. Progressive this, wow. Conservative this, wow. You know, this religion says this, wow. This attack, wow. This problem, wow. You know, I'll just, I don't pay any attention to the news. I don't watch it, so I don't need to do much of that. But it's like you live in a world where every, you know, the vibe is everywhere. So you can't help it. You can't really escape it. It's just, wow. Okay, here's the intensity. Wow. My reaction is wow. That's it. That's the label. The one label for all other labels. And so my attention stays very free, and I don't have a bunch of thoughts arising of contrasting labels, of thinking for, how do I label this, you know? How do I derive an I out of this, a singular illusion out of duality? Of course, we can't. A singular illusion would instantly be seen as abiding in intrinsic spaciousness, and then it wouldn't, you'd see there's nothing there at all as far as a separate self. So we want to work at it from 360 degrees. I've been saying this for a long time, and I'm, you know, I'm walking the walk too. Talking the talk and walking the walk. And I understand that the last month or so has been very difficult. Had a lot of trouble myself keeping it all going. You know, it's like the white waters hit me, but I'm still on my board. So I did a John, you know, I'm still on my board. I came out of it, you know, it's like, but I'm kind of like, wow, that was very intense. I almost fell. We don't want to fall. Very turbulent. We know polarity wars are coming, don't we? Once Trump's inaugurated the 21st of January, he's going to start going, don't. Now, I say he's more of the brutal type of personality, sure. I mean, I'm not trying to put someone down. I'm just delineating clearly. There's the mentally ill side. The liberals are very mentally ill, actually. And the conservatives are pretty brutal. A lot of them have the sort of brutal side, you know, to them. And so Trump is that way. He's very brutal in that way. I see wild boars a lot. I had this herd, like 30 of them around me a couple of days ago. I even had a dream of being surrounded by a herd of wild boar. And one thing I noticed is they're not intimidated at all. You cannot, I mean, they just are very territorial. And if you try to move in their territory, they're going to go at you. You know, and I see this heavy machinery around them. They're not scared by anything, these big boars. So I said, Trump's like this. Nothing intimidates him. No matter what they try to do to him, yeah. He said, you're not coming to my territory. You try to come to my territory, I'm going after you. You know, like that. I'm going after you with an army of lawyers or whatever, right? he's very, you know, very much like a wild boar type of thing. Very much so. Very, you know, brutal wild boar. But wild boars, you know, they're cool. And it's like, wow. They got their thing going on. I mean, they're very territorial. They're very successful, right? The herd increases. Amazing. They're very good at getting food. You know, they're survivors. But don't try to mess with them. Except you can throw stones. I saw someone throwing stones, and that seems they don't like that very much. What they do is they throw stones at the babies. The babies start running. The mothers then go out hustling after the babies, and then the big male boars have to hustle after the women, the female boars, and the babies to protect them. So that's how the herd moves. Is first you scare the children. And this is, of course, why our culture is all into scaring children. All the horror movies, all the terrible stuff that children are subjected to these days scares the children. And when the children are scared, the mothers are going to become affected by that. And when mothers are affected by it, the fathers also get pulled into that and be affected by it. That's just why when I grew up, like my parents refused to let us see any scary movies, any horror stuff, we didn't see movies, we didn't see television, none of that. It was all called wholesome material, wholesome, including my dad, a lot of high spiritual material, wholesome material. Don't grow up being frightened and scared by all this stuff. And so we had what's called a wholesome culture. Yeah, it was very much so. And this is, you know, much more helpful for the Dharma to have a wholesome culture, actually. Don't scare the kids. The kids should not grow up in a situation where people are throwing stones at them, but they feel scared. That drags the whole culture down, actually. But those who want to drag the culture down are aware of that. That's why they're targeting children. In so many ways, children target. You see, like, the games they play on their tablets and their smartphones and stuff. There's all these huge dinosaurs, you know, killing this and stuff. That terrifies the kids. Dinosaurs terrify them, these huge, monstrous dinosaurs. They've been doing that for the last about 40 years or so, introducing dinosaurs, these folks who want to destroy the Dharma, actually. I stay away from all those dinosaur motifs, reptilian motifs. Stay away from them. They're designed to frighten you. And this creates a chain reaction through culture, just like driving a herd of wild boar away, throw stones at the piglets, and the whole herd will move away out of your way. See? Like that. So, you know, they'll throw stones at Trump's children, but they're old enough, I think, probably to handle most of it. They're not little piglets anymore. So that hasn't worked so easily. They destroyed, like, Ross Perot by going after his family. They pulled his children down, then they pulled, you know, the wife down, then they pulled him down. He went out, left the race because of that. But Trump's like a big boar, and his family's kind of tough. So they weren't able to do that to him. They weren't able to do that. They certainly tried to throw as many stones as possible. Didn't work. And they'll keep trying for sure. But once he's inaugurated, then he's going to go boom, 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 boom. You know, he's going to start doing stuff rapidly. And it's going to freak the liberals out. Those with, you know, the mental, those with mental illness will be very freaked out by this because they're very fragile. And they like to feel, they want to be in control of everything. The mentally ill feel like they need to be, you know, fixated, have everything fixated the way they want it. And Trump's going to disturb all that. And so they're going to be really very, very vehemently angry. The kind of anger that mentally ill people have is very frightening. They can get ferociously angry. Now, sign of mental health is you virtually don't get angry at all. Or if you do, it's gone so quickly and with a laugh and like it never was. It's I've experienced this in my life, and right now I don't get angry. I don't get angry. I can admonish, you know, but it's still with a laugh and a smile and humorously, and shake my head and say, wow, you know, it's so messed up, but okay, moving on, and let's keep the Dharma going, like that. Just don't get angry. Don't hate. Don't get angry. I point out this is dangerous. This don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. But there isn't that brittle, you know, hostility that you feel from the mentally ill, the anger and the hostility, you know, that because they're terrified. They're terrified. All the defenses that they use to protect their mental illness from protect them from recognizing it and doing anything about it, that those start to vanish. They panic. They go into panic mode. When you go into panic mode, you get very angry and you start attacking viciously. So this is what's going to happen. The turmoil is going to be off the charts. And my lack of equilibrium that was showing me, I was, you know, like an advanced forecaster. I'm like an advanced forecaster to help others out here. I'm telling you, this is coming. We have to work on our balance. We really have to work on this core flexibility, you know, balance, strength, and then that leads to agility, the ability to be quite agile. And when you're agile, like John Florence is very agile. He's so agile. He's strong, but he's agile. I mean, his combination, great combination. And you don't fall. And you can go through these maneuvers. You can ride these tough waves. So we can ride out the tough waves that are coming in the world. Psychological tough waves. Agitation. All this. Ride them out and not fall. And if the waves get too huge, you can ride your board into the shore, just wait it out, which should be done to save the safety personnel on the jet skis there, who have a very dangerous job themselves. And they're out rescuing surfers that are getting clobbered. And if the waves just get too monstrous and dangerous, their job becomes too dangerous, because you're going to have people. What happens is, it just happened to, what's his name, Tim Lowe or something like that, from Great Britain. He was surfing in Ireland. He took this horrible wipeout in a really nasty wave. And he had a flotation device. He's very expert. And he was saved by the jet ski people. Otherwise, he would have died. So he said, this is what happened to me. I took this horrible fall. And the lip came down on me and hit me so hard, it knocked all the air out of me. It hit his chest so hard, it knocked the air out of him. And he said it paralyzed his arms. He couldn't move his arms. So he couldn't pull his... The cord on his inflation vest, they have a cord you pull, and the vest inflates, some CO2 cartridge there, I think, and that brings them to the surface then. So they're able to then float on the surface, and the jet ski people can see them and pick them up. He couldn't inflate it because his arms were paralyzed. So imagine this, a perfect storm, right? There's a great big wave surfer who survived so many huge, horrendous wipeouts, and it finally got to him. The wave hit him just in such a way as it knocked all the air out of his lungs. And he couldn't move his arms. It paralyzed his arms for some reason. He couldn't pull the cord. And he started just swallowing water. He was going to die. And the jet ski people found him, pulled him in, got the water out of his lungs, started giving him oxygen, and they saved his life. Couple days later, he was back at an even more horrendously dangerous place. Right? He's fine. These people are a little bit deranged, I think. Big wave surfers. But they're daredevils. The point is even if you're really, really good, if the waves are bad, nasty enough, you can put yourself in a life-threatening situation. And then you cause the jets, the safety people coming to rescue you, you cause them to be in a dangerous, very dangerous situation. Some of it at Nazaré in Portugal. There's got some very dangerous situations with the safety personnel. Their jet skis got wrecked. They had to try to retrieve them. They put themselves in very dangerous situations. It is really very tough. And so you don't want to do that. You don't want to. So if you're a real pro, you'll say, hey, maybe I could ride those waves that are coming in. But you know what? I mean, it's a better example not to ride them, because there's some guys out there that they're not as good as me, and they're going to wipe out. If they see me going out there riding the waves, they're going to have to macho. They're going to macho up and try to go out there and ride them too, okay? And they're going to just take horrendous wipeouts. I saw some of YMA were just horrendous. This guy should not be out there surfing, actually. I mean, yeah, he's good, but you shouldn't be wiping out that bad. That is really bad. And the guy, the commentator, said, oh my gosh, I hope we find him. I mean, this is scary. Yeah, it was. And so if you're like a great, the top dog, you know, out there, and you paddle in, say, no, you paddle in. You know what? Other guys are going to say, hey, if he's in, I'll save face by going in too. I won't lose face by paddling in also. Because the best in the world decided, no, I don't want to surf this, too dangerous. So I think it is too. So I'm going to paddle in. I won't lose face. No one will question me, like, hey, you know, he's still out there. How come you're not out there? So it helps that in that way. It helps. Plus, again, if he's out there and others are trying to surf the waves, they're taking these hideous wipeouts. It's putting everybody in danger. Everybody in danger. So it's better to set the example to, as Longchamp says, go to the wild woods. You know, paddle in if things get too tough, too hairy out there. I saw myself a dream last night, where I was by the ocean. It was this very calm area of the ocean, super calm. It was like a harbor. But just on the other side of this harbor, I could hear the waves were just raging. It was like just horrendous, horrendously dangerous waves. And yet in my little harbor there, super peaceful, calm little waves just flowing in. You know, it's like, I kind of said, huh. I said, well, so this that was put to be like, you want to stay here in this calm area. And so I just said, wow. Because there was some temptation to say, well, I want to try to maybe check out the waves and then the violence of it all and the, you know, just the turmoil of it all. It's kind of exciting. And I said, yeah, but, and this kind of seemed a little boring in comparison, but I said, well, you know, let me just stay here for a little while. Let me just see if I can get some beauty out of this area here. I was thinking, maybe I can get some beauty somehow. So had this house right on the ocean, right there in the ocean with this. And so something's going on in this regard, as far as taking refuge in a more serene setting and sidestepping the violent storms that are to come in this world. Let them rage, but set the right example. Make sure the Dharma continues on. So it can, you know, the seeds are still there, so it can flower at some other age. This is an age where it's not flowering well at all. There's been an attempt to, you know, commandeer it through, like I said, trying to combine it with, you know, science and technology and all this stuff. It just gotten all yoga, that kind of thing. It's the clarity has been lost on it. See, as Longchamp said, Dharma requires a very clear explanation, very fine explanation. But people are happy with half truths and half explanations now. He says, that's not the Dharma. It's not the Dharma. Dharma requires a very fine explanation, actually. So we don't really have the Dharma much in this world anymore. We don't. We really don't. But it's important to recognize that. There's so much of what's called non-duality and all this stuff. That's really not fine explanations being given out. Not really. Not really. There's some that are doing some Dharma work, yes. But the edge is off of it in the world right now. It's very much off of it. It needs to be much better, actually. There needs to be a 360 degree, you know, there has to be very keen understanding of blocking panic, the importance of that, and full stop on the wow of just one label for all other labels, blocking the panic in such a manner. And, you know, all this has to be very, you know, clearly present and explained. It needs a very fine, clear explanation. That's as long Chenpa's words. And I can understand what he's talking about now. So we don't have that in the world. We have it here, but most other places don't have it, unfortunately. And I can understand it's very difficult because nobody really pays attention right now. So if they want attention, they need to muddy the explanation up, because most people want to be told that they should just do whatever they want to do. This is Wangchampa's words also. He says, most people think Buddhist teachings, if you teach the truth, everybody hates and reviles you and tries to bully you, he says. But if you teach non-Dharma, but in Dharmic terms, then everybody says, oh yeah, that's what the Buddha would say. Okay, great, the Buddha just told us to do whatever we want to do. And they say, oh, we're happy, we're spiritually advanced, you know. And he said, that's trouble, that's the trouble. That's a dark age when that happens. This has happened here. It's a very dark age. Longchenpa's aware of it. That's why he's come back to help us with this dark age. He's been through troubled ages. Tibetan Buddhism has gone through various phases, some very dark ages, and he was actually had to flee Tibet, I think to Bhutan. The king tried to assassinate him. The king thought that he was siding against the king's rival, and in truth, Longchenpa was actually trying to calm everything down. The king's rival was trying to calm him down. So ultimately, Longchenpa was invited back to Tibet by the king. And it was explained to the king by some wise people there that this is what really happened. And then the king greatly apologized, and gave Longchenpa great honor in Tibet, realizing that he was not trying to take sides in the power struggles and stuff, the brutal power struggles. But he did literally have to flee and stay away from Tibet for quite some time. So he knows what it's like. He knows what it's like where we're at right now. Is a very, very nasty situation where people think that you're siding with their enemy, when in fact you're just teaching the Dharma. But they're so blind. The brutality and mental illness are so blind. Two sides of the same coin of blindness, actually. And that's what we've got now. We've got a world full of brutal people and a world full of mentally ill people, and not much else. Not much else. 100% minus, okay, are in that camp. And then we have, you know, a little bit of the Dharma coming out in a few places. This is one place where the Dharma is clearly explained. But we have to do a lot of work at it, don't we? And we're having trouble establishing conventions. I'm having trouble. I've established them myself, but they're not catching on. It's like the wood is wet. You know, the fire doesn't spread properly because the wood's all wet. You need the wood to be dry. You have to, and drying it out takes a while, doesn't it? Yeah, it's starting to get cold out here. It was really cold last night. Holy cow, it's chilly here in California, but it usually gets right around Christmas time. December is the coldest month, and around Christmas, that's when we experience the coolest weather. Yeah, you know, it was like last night, it was like 34. And, you know, it's not so bad. Like 50, 52, 54 today is a high. Yeah, pretty nice, right? But for us, it's like, oh, what's going on? Global cooling is going on. What's happening? So I've taken it easy. Saturday, Sunday, I was feeling ill. I'm tired, and it's cold. And I just said, you know, I'm working on a slideshow, Ram Maharshi, an amazing slideshow, but it's so much work, it's ridiculous. I don't know. I may have bitten off more than I can chew. We'll see. It's a colossal effort. But I love Ram Maharshi. He is another convention of ours, actually. He is so right on the money. He is so right. He is so right. Money in the bank, Ram Maharshi. Money in the bank. A true, true Dharma king. If ever there was one, the king of all ascetics. You'll never see a better ascetic than Ram Maharshi. You know, we're like super blessed. I just am in tears when I look at it. I just say, my gosh, it's hard to believe that we have such a great example in our time right now. I mean, there's no other time in history when anyone had any better example than Ram Maharshi, okay? Well, that's how fortunate we are. I mean, he's just as good as it gets, as good as it's ever going to get. And we have him, so many pictures, you know, of him and what he said. And it's just, and I've, like I said, I have a screensaver of with Ram Maharshi, all the slides. I have a folder with all these slides I have, pictures with quotes on them. And that I use that as my screensaver. So every time I get up in the morning, this slideshow is showing. When I come home from work, it's showing. When I go away for any amount of time and come back, the slideshow with Rama is showing of all these quotes. And so I'm, every single day I spend with Ram Maharshi, he's in my room. He's in the room with me all the time. See, that's the Dharma. You see how brilliant that is. That skillful means, it's called skillful means. So I come up with these skillful means. It's not easy. You have to be inspired. You have to suddenly get this burst of inspiration. Oh my gosh, I can do this. This is the difference between success and failure, is to be inspired. So pray to the Dharma kings to inspire you. Pray for inspiration. It will come. They're fabulous in answering prayers. So I'm doing this slideshow, and I said, oh gosh, you know, it's just in to honor Ramana. His birthday's coming up December 30th. I think I'll be, how old? I don't know, 137 years old. Or I mean, he arrived in this world 137 years ago, so to speak. But we have him. We have him, and we're not letting him go. Okay, we're not letting him go. He's a keeper. He's a keeper. An all-time keeper. And we are just, we don't even know how fortunate we are. Seriously. Because he really is the heart, in the heart of the Dharma. He's given the heart of the Dharma out. No compromise at all. It is just so, so astonishing to hear it, what he says. It's just, oh my gosh, he's so right. Wow. And he's blessed me quite a bit. I'm super blessed to be a friend of Ram Maharshi. And I've been with him most of my life. My dad was aware of him. But I had trouble with him. I just said, he's too much, you know. How can I live like that? And gradually, I was helped by one of his proteges, Punjaji too, who kind of explained Ramana from the inside. And I began to see, oh, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Because he knew him so well. He knew Ramana so well that some of what he wrote about Ram Maharshi, this really helped me. I said, oh, okay, yeah, he's flexible. Ramana is flexible. And he takes different approaches. And it showed him how he really was, instead of just sort of the spiritually romantic image that people had. And then I realized, oh, yeah, okay. And so it helped me accept him a lot more, realizing just how down-to-earth pragmatic he was. And he just knew it all. He knew it all. He knew exactly what he was doing in every direction. And he wasn't some rigid ideologue, you know, that I thought he was just this, you have to do the eye inquiry, nothing else ever works, and there's nothing else to do. It wasn't quite like that at all, really. He told Punjaji, look, you know, I give people what works for them, okay? I'm pragmatic, in other words. Punjaji asked him questions. Why do you do this? And you say this to that. And that. He says, look, I have to help people where they're at. Okay, so don't worry about it. He says, I say something different to you because you're a different place than they are. Not that it's conflicting. It doesn't really conflict. But he really was just this, like, perfect being here. He really was. He really was. I mean, there weren't any flaws in Ram Maharshi. He didn't have any flaws. And we keep looking for it, thinking, there must be some flaws. And there aren't any, actually. There aren't. So we have this example, dharmic example, which is absolutely tremendous. And there are others, too. The Queen of Wow, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Everything I said about Ram Maharshi could be said about her for sure. Flawless, absolutely flawless, perfect Dharma example. Both of them, flawless. Nothing bad you could say about either one of them. They had no flaws. And again, we think, well, how is that possible? How is that possible? It's so extraordinary, isn't it? Yeah, it is. And yet they're telling us, look, you can approximate this also. You can see, you can move into this. You can move into this perfection, this flawlessness, this smoothness, the sameness of being. It's there. It's our natural condition. We are you. And that's how I see them. I see I am Ramaharshi. Ramaharshi is me. I am Ramaharshi, like that. That's who I really am. Now, I might express it a little different in different ages, different culture, different place. But essentially, that's who I am. That's how you, and I say you, that's who you are also. We're all that. We're all that way, actually. Same with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the Queen of Wow, I say, I am that. And she is me. That's my true self right there. Clear as a bell. I see it. That's what I really am. I really feel it too. I say, well, I'm sure of it. I say, that's my true self right there. That's what I really am. That's what you are. That's what all of us really are. That just like that. We're just like that, actually. We're just trying to put imaginary qualities or restrictions to the mind, imaginary restrictions on the mind, which don't exist. So that these Dharma kings know the mind isn't restricted by imagination, imaginary restrictions at all. Not at the slightest bit, never has been. But the imaginary restrictions we put on the mind are like time, space, process, and form. None of those exist at all. But we're imagining the mind is restricted by those. So we expect then our experiencing that the mind is producing to reflect these restrictions. And lo and behold, we have this world here, which it comes entirely from our imagination, based on these imaginary restrictions that we think the mind is now restricted by. And it's not. It's not restricted by any of that. So truly, there isn't any world at all in terms of anything other than just our free imagination. There's no time-based world, there's no space-based world, there's no process-based world, and there's no form-based world at all. It's never existed. We're just expecting it to exist, so we keep imagining it as if it does exist. But it's really, moment by moment, it's just our imagination, our collective imagination. It's just imagining all of this. There isn't anything other than that ever present at all. Imaginary restrictions to the mind lead to imaginary expectations that our experiencing will be in line with those imaginary restrictions, okay? And yet, it's all hallucinations, so to speak. It's all a hallucination. There's never been any births. There's never been any deaths. There's never been any form. Nothing has ever happened. It's all just pure ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. That's all that's happening. That's all that's ever happened. Okay, that's the truth. And the Dharma kings, they tell us that's absolutely the truth. And I've seen it. It's absolutely true. And we just need to let our attention, settle down on this, which the polarity battles coming up are going to be very problematical for us to have our attention settle, because families are so polarized now. It's just crazy, right? I'm sure you're in a situation where your friends, you feel your friends may not be your friends going forward, right? Your family may not be good family members going forward. I'm in the situation, totally, right? Absolutely, I am. So if you're in that situation, and welcome to the club, because I'm certainly in that situation. We all are. If you're with the Dharma, most of the world is not with the Dharma. And they're expressing just the opposite, actually. Just the opposite. That you're a person, human person, that's taken birth in an actual world, who's here to do good and help others and to make the best of it. And all this kind of, it's all nonsense. That's total nonsense. It's totally non-dharmic. Totally non-dharmic. So most of the do-gooders in the world are completely non-dharmic. Okay, and they're giving the complete opposite. They're using their do-gooding to foster non-dharmic culture, falsity, complete falsity, which is egoic arrogance. It's our own arrogance. To foster really arrogance, self-righteous arrogance, is what they really lead. That's what it leads to, actually. So it really leads to collapsing dharmic culture, at least trying to. You cannot collapse the Dharma kings, though, at all. So That's something that's so important to realize. Ram Maharshi, you cannot collapse him, okay? It's impossible. So he's our friend. He's our friend. And friends look out after friends. He's looking out after us. I got a heads up yesterday that the Dzogchen Nyingma masters are looking out after me. There's no question about it. They gave me the indication. It was really quite profound. It's like, wow, they're watching me like an eagle, like a hawk. You know, anyone who tries to mess with me, they're on them like a hawk. They really are. And because I ask them to. They don't do it unless you ask them. And why don't we ask for help? Because we're afraid they'll make our path go too fast. Okay, so you wonder, why do I get tripped up so much? Because we want to. It slows us down. Why did I get a bad deed? To slow down. That's why. But we can ask for protection. We'll get it. And then our path will be very smooth and fast. And then we think, oh my gosh, it's so smooth, it's so fast, I might finish real soon, yeah. And then we say, oh, okay, I don't need that much protection. And then they back off because you requested it. And then you get tripped up. Then you say, wow, God, how come you didn't, you know, how come Dharma Kings, you didn't protect me? I asked you to protect me. No, we asked them to back off a little bit, which they had to do, pretty much so. Or risk your wrath and getting really upset. Like, no, I'm going too fast. You're pressuring me. You're forcing me. You know, this is horrible. Because it feels that way, like you're being, you know, unduly dragged along towards the finish line, right? So we can get protection. It's just most of us don't ask for it. That's a fact. I've noticed that throughout my life. You know, this is true. So sometimes I feel in danger because I'm telling the Dharma Kings, hey, I don't want you like protecting me too much because I don't want to go too fast. And then I feel a sense like, uh-oh, you know, maybe some troubles will come. And they, you know, they start coming and then I say, okay, whoa, I need some protection. And then boom. They dissolve. So the Dharma Kings are watching us like a hawk. I keep telling them, hey, come on, watch me more closely. No, they are. They are. I got this indication yesterday. It was quite an extraordinary experience. Queen of Wow, Sri Sri Anandamayama, told us that nothing escapes her attention. Even the minutest detail, she's totally, vividly aware of. She watches her devotees like a hawk. You know, not to try to coerce them, but meaning making sure that nobody messes with them. Nothing messes with her devotees, right? She's aware of all circumstances that could drag them down. And the devotee says, help, don't let me be dragged down. She'll make sure they're not. She'll step in and make sure and dissipate the trouble. Absolutely, they'll dissipate it. So I'm working, you know, really, really working on asking for help and accepting their help. Because, of course, it's going to make me go really faster on the path. For sure it will. And that's the price I got to pay, you know, for protection. It you don't get messed with, your momentum keeps going. You don't fall off your board. You keep riding the wave, you know. It's getting chilly out here, I tell you. It is. So I'm going to have to bring this to a close at some point here before I freeze. In California, we freeze easily. We were outdoors dining, Christmas Eve dinner, got taken, treated. And we were outdoors, that heater's out, but my feet got really cold. I said, man, I'm not used to this. But of course, here I am on Christmas Day wearing swim trunks. I was wearing a tank top and swim trunks. So that's the new look, tank top and swim trunks. Getting ready for the, you know, something, what's coming, the new year with the new good habits and the dharmic momentum. Still powerful dharmic momentum is present here. Very powerful. You know, totally key recognitions are happening regularly now. And it's just like, okay, wow. Shock, shock, shock. Stay humble, humble, humble. Humility is the greatest virtue of all because this allows you to be shocked by clarity and then wow the clarity, wow the shock, and block the panic. But while you're shocked, you're not the life of the party. Okay, so I've never been the life of the party in my life. Never. because I've been continuously focused on the Dharma my whole life. And I've been stunned by it, shocked and stunned. It's just, you know, my success has been so great. It stunned me every day of my life. So, oh my gosh, I'm really getting there. This is so amazing. And so when you're shocked and stunned, you become kind of flat. You know, you seem kind of flat as far as your liveliness goes. And I've been flat my whole life that way. So people just pass me by, you know, I don't seem like the life of the party. And maybe I was getting too much of the life of the party when I was so agile, and maybe I had the knee problems to slow me down, so I'd get my humility back. I was starting to get a little bit too confident, in my opinion. And this is a danger. You want to stay humble. It's the greatest virtue of all. When you talk about the virtues, Christianity's big on this, you know, the virtues, you know, modesty, humility, kindness, forgiveness, generosity, you know, there's a lot of these virtues. That's very important for Dharmic culture, to cultivate these virtues. But the greatest is humility. All the rest of them then come from humility. But humility is a very pragmatic thing. It means that you're having so much success, you're shocked. Almost every day you're in shock. And you don't struggle with the shock, you accept it. When you accept the shock, when you don't get shocked about the shock, then you don't panic. So this is what my teaching that I'm so keen on, that I'm really helping reintroduce to the world and re-clarify and keep it going, is don't struggle with the struggle. Don't be shocked about the shock. Accept it. Embrace it. And say, this is okay, I accept it. This is the price I'm paying for my liberation from cyclic samsaric existence, which is just cycling through brutality and mental illness ceaselessly. You know, that's not much fun, is it? So I want to get free of that. So this is the price that you have to pay. You're not the life of the party. So my whole life, I've just people have just viewed me as kind of a dullard. It's kind of stupid dullard, really. He doesn't have much to bring to the party at all. Really, seriously, this has been my life. But not because I'm that way at all. I'm like a great singer with bronchitis my whole life. And I say, hey, folks, you don't know. I can sing like, you just can't believe how great I can sing, but I've got terrible bronchitis and I can't do it right now. And of course they say, ah, you're a liar. You know, yeah, what a liar, you know. What a braggart, what a liar. We don't believe you. And I say, what can I say? You know, I know it's true. It's funny, I've had a cold recently and I can't sing very well at all right now. And I'm thinking, hey, you know, this isn't really, if someone hears me, they'll think I'm a lousy. But once the cold clears up, then it's a different story. I get it back and I'm just like zooming all over the place like a hummingbird. So I know I can do it, but other people, they don't believe it. So this has been my life, and the life on the Dharmic life is supposed to be like this. Okay, you're not. Dharmic culture does not raise up the heroic life of the party archetype as a model at all. It raises up the model of humility. That's the model we should follow. Christianity has tried to do this. You know, Christianity, 2,000 years, they've done a lot of good work. It's just recent materialism has been sabotaging them for the last 500 years, and they've done a great job of sabotaging it, unfortunately. But that's what happens. Okay, so I just have to accept that this is what happens in samsaric existences, is that ceaselessly trying to sabotage the Dharma, ceaselessly. And they do it because that's what they want. That's what they want. The Dharma is not really sabotage. I mean, I can easily establish it like that because it's so simple. You just block panic. There's one step of the one learning, just don't be shocked about the shock. Except humility means you go through life kind of like, you know, a little church mouse. You know, nobody thinks you're anything special at all. People just pass me by my whole life like I'm nothing. And that's pretty tough to do. Because in previous lives, I was really a big shot. In this life, I was like, wow, nobody thinks I'm anything at all. It's you know, kind of difficult. But it's what works. Because then you're able to live a life of wow, shock. Of the wow of clarity, being shocked by clarity every single day, which is my life. Every day I'm shocked by clarity, tremendous clarity every day. So I'm always in a state of kind of semi-shock all the time. And so I'm just kind of a little bit out of sync. You know, I'm not one of these, you know, bubbly people who can just, you know, make people laugh and shine, you know, like shining, you know, life of the party type. I'm not. I'm kind of like, keeping to myself because I feel like, wow, I feel really stunned. I'm kind of in a stunned condition. It's like that. So we call this humility, is you accept it. Humility means you accept kind of the stunned shock condition and you don't try to struggle to get rid of it. See, what happens is when we try to struggle to get rid of it, that's when panic sets in. And then from panic, fixation sets in. And from fixation setting in, mental illness sets in. Okay? So that's the road you want to block. So humility blocks all of that. It blocks the panic, it blocks the fixation, it blocks the mental illness. And you just accept yourself as this kind of nondescript, you know, nobody that nobody really cares about or feels as important in any way. Doesn't have anything to say, you know, just they can't deliver it properly anyway. You know, it's like someone who can sing a song but they got bronchitis, so it doesn't sound so good. This has been the story of my life. My whole life is just like this. Overlooked, passed by. And just accepting it, and gradually, I didn't understand it at first. It was really difficult. Now I understand that's the path. It's because I kept studying and being shocked every day by high spiritual content, high dharmic content, was really just always stunned by it. I still am stunned by it. The clarity this morning stunned me. Every morning, every day, I'm stunned by what happens. So I just accept, I just walk past people kind of, if someone smiles, says hello, I'll say hello. But I don't even try to be somebody, you know, I don't even try. Maybe I was trying a little bit too much. Maybe that's why the knees acted up on me. I was trying to be somebody a little too much. And this one still hurts. There's still some pain there. Ouch. I hit that, there's no pain. I hit this one, there's pain. Ouch. Yeah. So it's saying, nah, come on, don't lose your humility here. Don't lose your, yeah. As the clarity is more and more acceptable to me, the shock wears off, then I become more and more of the life of the party type. But I'm not really used to that. See, I'm my whole life I've been this just, you know, wallflower, basically, my whole life. So coming out of that, it's starting to be more the life of the party. I'm just like, whoa, you know, careful with this. I'm not really so comfortable with that, actually. I prefer to fly under the radar. Flying under the radar is the best way. This is a humble life. So the Dharma holds up the humble life as the ideal, whereas non-Dharma culture holds up, you know, the opposite, right? Pretty much the opposite. And even, you know, even it may hold up superstars doing charity work and all this stuff, but they're still superstars. They're still the life of the party there. Whereas a true humility, nobody really notices anything you do. You know, like if I were to have a funeral, maybe nobody would show up at all, okay? And they wouldn't have anything to say about my life at all. I mean, what could they say? I have no idea what my epitaph or a eulogy would be. People don't even know me at all. They just think I'm some idiot who likes the Giants and golfed a little bit, and pretty much I don't know anything else about them really. I'm just this bland nobody of no accomplishment whatsoever. So I basically can't have a funeral right now because I you know, they couldn't eulogize me. It's a good excuse not to die, isn't it? I gotta wait till somebody can eulogize me properly, and they can't at this point at all. What's that? Oh, it's a phone. What did I do? I hit something. Oh. I keep forgetting my phone. I leave it everywhere. That means I'm not really interested in phones anymore, you know. I've never fallen in love with technology, electronics. I never did. I never will be in love with electronics. So I'm not interested in a future guided by a fixation, really. It's a fixation with electronics. Most people are fixated at this point, which will lead to severe mental illness, no question about it. Or tremendous brutality, or both. Actually, but we may have both coming at us. Brutality and mental illness will be assaulted on all sides by this polarity. This is the polarity of the world. People either mentally ill or brutal kind of temperaments. And we're seeing, you know, we've seen a lot of brutality in the world recently, haven't we? But what we don't realize is there's been a tremendous amount of mental illness in the world also since 2001, 9/11. tremendous amount of mental illness in the world. It's been there, getting worse and worse for quite some time. And also now tremendous amount of brutality in the world, right? Both, right? They're both, and so that's the dichotomy that we're, that's, we feel trapped, you know. But we have this other option of the Dharma, which is what? Good habits and establishing conventions. So you may need to look up, I mean, how do you establish a convention? I do a lot of work. I'm always working. It's taken me months to actually be able to look at John Florence. Months, actually, of working and surfing, sort of looking at it and getting used to it and trying to... Months of work. Pretty much every day, actually. So, really, to establish conventions, it may take months of work. You can't just go to Wiki, okay, read it, say, okay, I got it. It's not quite that easy, really. It doesn't really establish a convention. You have to look at his videos. You have to spend time with him and watch him more than once. Go over it again, and the next day do it again, and the next day do it again. And start building a convention saying, hey, I could see that's a great example, you know. I want to start following that example. I want to start finding something to balance on. I want to start being aware of my balance, and why am I losing my balance? And what could I do to not lose my balance? And then say to yourself, you develop a shorthand. You say, hey, I want to be like JJ. Or I want to be like John. I want to be able to make these radical maneuvers, these maneuvers, and ride the big waves, but I don't want to fall. I want to be able to handle the world, what's going to happen, but I don't want to fall. Now, I'm learning some of the tricks, so I will, you know, pass those on to you. But again, the conventions like Ram Maharshi, you got to know Ram Maharshi. I mean, we have these conventions. It's all important because... shorthand. We have to use shorthand. We have to go briskly. This was the Queen of Wow, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma's advice to everyone. She says, your path must be brisk. She said that to everyone. It's the key element. Otherwise, we'll stall out. So always, she was trying to pick up the pace. It's a little more brisk, a little more brisk. Always, she would say that to everyone. A little more brisk. You've got to do. You do. How many? What's your practice? 10 minutes a day? Can you do 20 for me? Can you do 20 minutes? And then next time she'd see them, she'd say, well, how you doing? She never forgot. How are you doing your 20 minutes now? She never forgot. Everyone she'd see, even if you hadn't seen them for 30 years, she knew exactly what she had told them, exactly what their path was. She had perfect memory or awareness. It was just, you know, perfect, just flawless being. And doing 20 minutes, okay, that's great, but I want you to do a half an hour now. Can you do a half an hour for me? Next time I see you, I want you to tell me you're doing a half an hour. And so she kept trying to attract them to making their path brisk. That was a very strong purpose, and she was able to make my path brisk. Okay, she's still attracting me to make it even brisker. That's one of the great things she does. She did. She's really good at that. And it's essential. Essential. Essential, because continuity fear has to evaporate gradually. We're not going to do it all at once. Familiarity needs to set in gradually. And then gradually we get more and more accepting that nothing ever happened. And when our attention finally rests on that, then we see, yeah, I know nothing ever happened. And we call that sudden enlightenment. But it's both sudden and gradual. Enlightenment is both sudden and gradual. We gradually get used to sudden, that it's sudden. We gradually come to the recognition that, oh, it is sudden. It's all at once. It's because there's nothing, there's no realizer. There's no realizer. There's no one to realize anything at all. In terms of a realization, we've always been what we are. There's not some separate realizer that has a realization. We are it. We are reality. It's not that we're someone realizing reality. No, we've always been reality. We are it. So it's not an I realizing reality, the nature of reality. It's not like that. We're abiding as it. It's abidance. It's not realization, it's abidance. So when we realize there's no one to realize and no realization, then we recognize abidance is This is it. I abidance, and we just abide. It's abidance. So to get that, you need brisk gradualism, to then ultimately reach abidance, which is all at once. They call it all at once, sudden enlightenment. But there have been those who've had this experience and then they lost it, you know. So is that really enlightenment? No, because they still think there's someone, some realizer, where there isn't. So realizing there's no realizer, how can there be a realization? And when we give up the attempt at having a realization, which means a realizer, when we give that up, we recognize abidance, because that's what we already are. We experience it. We experience it. We don't realize it. We experience it. We experience it. That's our natural being. We're just experiencing natural being. There's no one realizing natural being. There's just the experience of natural being. And that's all there is. That's all there is. So these Dharma kings are very helpful for us. Very helpful. So pray for inspiration. Pray that you get these conventions going in your life. That is the difference between success and failure. I see these guys wiping out on waves, and I see John, you know, take some of the really good ones. For instance, John is the best surfer in the world right now. And, you know, he doesn't wipe out, he makes it. He makes it. And it just says, wow, why is he making it and they're wiping out? Very interesting. They'll take off on the same wave, and one will have this horrible wipeout, but he won't wipe out. I say, wait a minute. Huh. Because he knows how to charge it. He knows how to be brisk in what he's doing. When he's surfing, he does it briskly. And the others hesitate. Big waves like that, he who hesitate is lost, you know. If you hesitate, you won't drop in quickly enough and with decisively enough. And then the lip is sucking up in the wave. The waters are actually traveling up the wave face, being sucked up very, very rapidly, actually. And if it catches your board, you get sucked up too close to the lip. You get sucked up, and then it just spits you out upside down, and you just have a horrendous free fall wipeout, where you might fall like 30 feet or something, then hit the water, wham! I mean, try hitting water. You know, divers do jump 30 feet. You hit it hard. If you hit it on your face or something, man, that knocks the air out of you. And then you don't have any air underwater at all. So to catch the waves, you have to commit, and you have to be brisk about it. You have, in your mind, you say, okay, I'm going to be dropping in here. So catching, as you're catching it, you say, okay, I'm going. So now the drop in, I'm committed to the drop in, and I know that at some point I'll have to be committed to keeping my balance in the white water and stuff. So in the mind, you're already set. I can do this, and so I'm committed and I'm doing it very briskly. Everything I'm doing is brisk. There's no hesitation there. You can see it's very fluid, and it's just wow. It's called charging. That's why they call big wave riders chargers. That's the term they use, chargers. So that's another convention. We need to be chargers. We need to be Dharma chargers. Okay, Dharma chargers. Now, you see, like, religions, they work hard on establishing these conventions. Like, you see these Protestant, you know, pastors. They're up there lecturing, you know, giving this long talk, and everybody's paying attention. What are they doing? They're establishing conventions is what they're doing. So they have these buzzwords they establish, and the Christians know these buzzwords, and so it's all shorthand. So they can very rapidly get what's being talked about and focus in quickly. That's a religion. Religion are people that have a common set of conventions, and use those conventions as shorthand. So we have to do the same. We have to have conventions. We have to, or you'll stall out. So chargers, you know, Dharma chargers. We charge the wave of Dharma. We charge it, you know. We know what we're doing. Full stop in the wow, and so we're dropping in, and we're making that drop, and we make the drop, and then we know the turn, and we know, you know, okay. So how are we going to, you know, ride the wave? What kind of wave is it? And then how do we exit the wave? And we know we've got great balance, so we feel we can keep our balance, you know, in certain areas. All that confidence going for us is we don't say, wait a minute, should I go? Should I not go? Should I go? Should I not go? Oh, I'm trying to drop in, but I don't really want to go. And it's too late then. It's too late. It's too late. He who hesitates is lost. He who hesitates is lost. So we're dropping in. We're charging the wave. Look at how John charges the wave. He really charges it. When he's paddling, I mean, you just, it's a sudden burst, like, I am going on this way. I am charging this wave. And he just, you know, wow. He gets the drop in going immediately, pushes it, and is into it right away. Gets into it right away. No messing around. And that, you know, seeing that, you say, wow, that's how we should charge the Dharma, actually. You just charge it. And you do that because conventions and shorthand, he knows his craft, he knows surfing. We should know the Dharma. We should understand Ramaharshi. We know that convention. Boom. We don't have to say, well, who's Ramaharshi? That's a funny man. Why does he wear a loincloth? That's a weird lifestyle, you know. And all, you know, that just completely dissipates the momentum, doesn't it? It's ridiculous to say those things. You know, someone in the Dharma should know, especially at this day and age, and should know Ramaharshi. That's a convention. It's a Dharmic convention, Ramaharshi. And so I'm trying to establish that. It's so important. You have, and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the queen of wow, is a Dharmic convention. If we don't have those, we're really handicapping ourselves by not having these Dharmic conventions. And these are recent ones. And Jesus Christ is another one, but he's gotten so sabotaged over thousands of years. Buddha, too, has been sabotaged so badly. But we have these two very recent, Jamyan Khyentse Chokyi Lodra also, right in many of our lifetimes, okay? They're very recent. We have pictures and video of them, and I've talked to people who have known them, you know, and met them. I mean, like we have David Godman, who spent time with Raman, I believe. I could be wrong about that, actually. Now, maybe I'm wrong about that. He came to the ashram. But Ramana passed away in 1950, so that's 66 years. It's been 66 years, so though you'd have to be pretty old to have met Ramana. You'd have to be over 66 years old, you know, and if you weren't really young, you might be 76, 86. So if you're 20 years old, you'd have to be 86 years old at this point. But I've talked to those who've met Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. She passed away in, 1982. So they're recent. They're recent. So they're fabulous conventions to have. Of course, Longchenpa is another great convention. Not too much is known about him. People don't really know him so well. But he's the great Nyingma lineage, Dzogchen lineage, which is still present in various ways in the world. But the Ramana, what a, you know, we should, everybody should know Ramana Maharshi. Anyone who's interested in the Dharma, truly, which is spiritual momentum of any background, Christian, whatever, we should know who Ramana Maharshi is. And they shouldn't be saying, well, why is he wearing, just wears a loincloth? He's the king of the ascetics. I mean, come on, you should know, people should know this. That's a great tradition in southern India. He gave all his clothes, all his money away like St. Francis and went to live in the wilds. I mean, he abandoned the world at 15, as a teenager, totally abandoned the world in one step and never looked back at all. It was all gone for him, just like that. Never a regret at all. Total commitment. So he didn't have any clothes. His loincloth was the only clothes that he owned. He never touched money again. He didn't have any money. He didn't have any possessions. He had nothing. He had a staff, I guess you could say, as he took his walk. But he was barefoot. He'd walk barefoot with a loincloth on his staff, and that's it. You know, basically, right? I mean, he was a total renunciate, total ascetic. The real deal. The total real deal. Perfect realization. You know, perfect experiencing of the smoothness of intrinsic spaciousness, perfect experiencing of it. So we can, you know, bring him into the mix. And, you know, we should, we know that we talk about Ram Maharshi here. You know, it shouldn't be right away. It's just like Christianity. They say we're talking about Saint Paul, we're talking about Saint Peter, we're talking about Saint Francis, or something. Like that. People, Christians know, okay, this is the saint. We understand the saint. We've studied the saint. You have to study. You have to be aware. You have to study. You have to immediately get it, and not say, "No, wait, what? Who is this again? Now, what did they do?" You know, that is called stall out, and that causes wipeout on a big wave. So we're riding big waves here. Dharma is all about big wave riding, you know, barrel riding, big wave riding. You know, sometimes the waves are not big, but then there's, you know, radical maneuvers on the wave. But it's all about surfing the Dharma. I mean, it is, you're making brisk success. I mean, you're doing really great stuff. And in order to do that, these conventions have to be there. Really, look at Tibetan Buddhists. I mean, how they educate their monks and stuff. Wow, you know, I mean, it's just practice, 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 conventions, conventions, conventions from the day they're born. The tulkus, right? Can they learn all those conventions? They learn all those practices. That's the Dharma, you know. You have to push it. You have to push it. You have to catch that wave. You have to really be committed to it. And a lot of times that, you know, you're going to get hammered at some point by the wave. That's what Russell Berkey says. You know, they asked him, "How do you do this? I mean, why are you so good? It's amazing." You know, he says, "Look, before I go out, I realize I'm going to get hammered out there. I know I am. I just hope I don't get hammered too bad. And I know I'm going. There's trouble out there. I'm just going to try to avoid as much trouble as I can. But I know it's going to hit me. I'm going to get hammered. And I'm just going to try to, you know, stay on my board, do the best I can." So you have to be tough. You have to be tough. We know the world's going to hammer us, okay? But we have to be tough enough to clear it up. That's why it's so cold. To, you know, get through that time. Take our beating and keep on ticking, as we used to sell Timex watches. Takes a beating and keeps on ticking. Now it's GoPro. You throw it up in the air, it hits the ground. It just keeps recording. Okay. Whew. I'm still learning stuff about the GoPro. I keep making mistakes. It's like, wow, I didn't know that. You know, it's tough. It's you have to know what you're doing. Not make so many mistakes, but that you learn from your mistakes. I make a lot of mistakes. You know, it's not like I just do stuff flawlessly. I make mistakes all the time, but I'm always trying. So I keep recognizing, oh, it's a mistake, and then smooth it out, smooth it out, smooth it out. So that's not a mistake, you know, in the future. So don't be afraid of your mistakes. Find what they are. Find out what they are. That's the Dharma. Find out your mistakes. Recognize your mistakes. Ram Maharshi said, the intelligent mind examines itself. The intelligent mind examines itself. It's not examining other minds like, hey, why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? It examines its own mind. So we should be examining our own mind, looking within our own mind, instead of criticizing other people and politics and all this kind of stuff. Forget that. Look at it within your own mind. Catch your own mistakes you're making, and you'll get better and better at that, and you will begin to recognize some key mistakes. Like, oh my gosh, I see that. Wow, I saw it. Wow, just wow it. So I hope, I ate too much last night. Hardly could sleep. I'm not used to eating big meals. I just sip smoothies during the day, pretty much, and snack a little bit. I don't have big meals. I don't sit down to big meals at all. So when I try to sit down to big meal, get treated, I get sick. I feel terrible. It almost kills me. It's horrible. I can't handle big meals anymore. So I don't have these set meals that I eat. I just snack a little bit during the day, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, little hand of walnuts, little hand of pecans, a few crackers, some peanut butter here and there. That's the smoothie. You know, I'm just like that. Which is very healthy, actually. It's very healthy. You don't overtax your system. Those big meals kill you. I mean, they overtax. People just are such sloths, you know. They're such brutes, you know. Really, they're so mentally ill or brutes. Their lives. We were at that restaurant last night. God, they were so pagan. It was just, I can't take it, you know. It's just so horrifying. You see these brutal, brutish pagans, like pigs. At slop, you know, just eating, gorging themselves, and all, of course, all the women are dressed up in such finery. They're such pigs, you know. They really are. from the Dharma standpoint, they're just pagan pigs, is all they are. It's repulsive. The more women try to make themselves beautiful, the more they're repulsive they are from a dharmic standpoint. And the more women simply don't do that and are modest, the more beautiful they are. Actually, the more like cherished they are and respected from a dharmic standpoint. There's nothing more I respect more than seeing a woman who's truly dharmic, you know, and just say, wow, she's not trying to attract my attention any way. She's truly humble. Truly humble, truly humble. I say, wow, that's great. That's awesome. Thank you very much. That's how it is. So that restaurant experience, holy cow. And the men with these big wild boar pigs, you know, with these grotesque women. They're all grotesque. Grotesquely stuffing their faces in every last way possible. Drinking wine, laughing, taking pictures. You know, I was like, these women are dressed up in all these ridiculous costumes, you know. It just blows my mind. I said, what are you doing? It's totally brutish, you know. There's some Christian women at church that, you know, they dress very, so humble. I'm so appreciative of it. You know, I just like, wow. That's the way to do it, you know. I can tell they're very humble because they're old style Christians. But others are most of them are really now putting on the ritz, like, you know, look at me, you know. Look how I'm the life of the party. Christianity's got, it's helped me so much. I'm really the life of the party now. You know, like they come just, their hair's done up and so in their dresses. They're all, you know, pomp and circumstance and self-righteousness thing. Wow. It's just, it's grotesque, actually, very grotesque. There's some woman in front of us yesterday at church. She was basically bald. She just had some real thin hair, like looked like a man with real thin hair. But she didn't do anything to disguise it, no makeup, no nothing. And I said, wow, that's so nice. I said, you look great, you look great. You know, you have a humble demeanor about you. A humble demeanor. That's the greatest virtue on the spiritual path. All other virtues come from that because, again, you're allowing yourself to be shocked and stunned by the great progress you're making on the path. And the more clarity you see, oh my gosh, I'm really moving along so well here. Wow, that's so simple. It's so simple. I can't lose at all. I can't lose. It's impossible. And you see this. Shocking, shocking, shocking. So when you're shocked, you're just kind of sitting there. You're just kind of sitting there, like I'm just sitting here now, you know. Don't have much to say to anybody. Don't have many smiles for people. Don't really feel like interacting much. You don't really feel like dressing up and putting on the ritz at all. You don't really feel like being a pig, okay, at all. You know, I'm not really interested in food. I'm not really interested in doing much. I don't really feel like doing much at all. You're not the life of the party. Hey, you know, bon vivant, let's go do this, let's go do this, hey, come on, no, you're not, you just don't feel that way, just, you know, and all of the party girls, and, you know, pass you by, say, oh, you know, you're not, you know, hey, come on, we want to have a party here, you know, you're not, and the bon vivants pass you by, if you're a woman, you know, they say, oh, she's no fun, so you're just a little drab nothing, and accepting that, humility, that's humility. Don't panic. Don't be shocked at the shock. Don't be shocked by the shock. Don't struggle with the struggle. Just let it be there and smile and just say, wow, this is great. Just wow. So that's me when I'm often very intense, serious. I'm in the wow because I just had my mind blown away by the clarity I've seen. I just say, oh, that is so precious. Just stunned by how precious it is. People think I'm poor. I'm a spiritual trillionaire. But I'm shocked by my spiritual wealth. You know, I'm so shocked by it. I go, good Lord. The treasures I'm accumulating, the dharmic treasures I'm accumulating are just extraordinary. So I'm like just, wow. I'm a Dharma prince. I'm being blessed by massive treasures. Prince has treasures, right? I'm getting more and more treasures all the time. I'm becoming a wealthy Dharma prince. And it's like, whoa. Wow. Not whoa, but wow. I'm shocked. I'm stunned. So the prince is not strutting around like, you know, I'm like, can I handle this? Wow, I got to get used to this. This is really stunning. So I accept being stunned. I accept being shocked and just let it play out. Let it gradually evaporate. It'll gradually, you know, it clears out, settles down. I just don't say anything. I'm used to just being totally inconspicuous, totally under the radar. Just, you're very, very used to it. And whenever I try to come out of that, people are kind of like, look at me like, what's the matter with you? You know, you okay? And then I go back into it. I say, I know, I feel great. I'm just trying to be more myself, you know, not my non-stunned, non-shocked self. So, I'm not used to that. Go back to being shocked. So it's kind of hard to get out of being shocked for me, right? Because everyone just thinks, oh, that's who he is. No, that's just me being shocked for my whole life. That's not who I am at all. I'm like this fabulous surfer guy, you know, I mean, fabulous singer. I mean, just this fabulous playfulness, creativity, you know, that's what I really am. Just, you know, that's what we all are. We're just a super creativity. But nobody knows me that way because I've been shocked my whole life, which is great because that's the path. That's the Dharma path. That's what works. So follow that example. Follow the example. Fly under the radar. Be very inconspicuous and yet be briskly gradual, very briskly gradual with your conventions and your good habits and your full stop in the wow. Just say, okay, I'm shocked. Wow. Just like that, you're just, wow. So I'll go in, you know, the computer, see if I can do some work editing or something, but most of the time I'm just like, wow. Just letting it calm down, just letting it settle. Just holy smokes, I'm so blessed. It's difficult to keep up. The blessings are so extreme. Videos I've been making, for me, they're such blessings. Just such blessings. They're so profound. They're so sublime. They're just so, I just say, wow. How blessed am I to be able to take part in this? And just giving the intensive, how blessed I am to be able to, you know, share an intensive. That's a tremendous blessing. It really is. So I'm just kind of wowing that. I'm so wowed by it, you know. I'm not the life of the party of the intensive either. Maybe it's a boring intensive, you know, because I'm wowed by it. But that's what it's really about. It's subtle. You look back and you say, oh, so that's what it was about. Wow. So let us swagger into the new year in a humble way, brisk gradualism. Humble swagger. Okay, you need your confidence. You need your swagger. I have swagger. I have confidence a lot, but it's this humble swagger, humble confidence, knowing that the very next minute I may be knocked off my feet by great clarity. For sure, I will be actually, and you know, I'll lose my swagger for a while. That's how it goes, right? Just, oh my gosh, that may be just too great for me. That's too sublime, maybe, but maybe not. So let's settle, see how I feel a little later down the road. Sleep on it and see how you feel. Okay, right now I feel pretty cold. Very cold, actually. I'm starting to shiver. Oh, gosh. Okay, well, we did 2 hours. This is so very great. Merry Christmas to everybody, and Happy New Year to everyone. And as you can see, I'm still doing pretty good, right? Yeah. I've still got it. I've still got it. Maybe better than ever. Like I say, I still got this. Still got the confidence. Still have the swagger. But I'm, you know, keeping it real. As we say, keeping it real, keeping it humble. There's more to come. There's more to come. It gets better and better and better for sure. And we need it to, because the polarity The white water's coming. Okay, so get your balance swagger on. Seriously, pray for inspiration on this. I have this foam roller that you get for your back and for your, you know, you get them at fitness stores. These, and I step on it with shoes and I use it as like a little mini skateboard or something in the room where I can hold on to stuff if I start to fall. And I just use that all the time. I take a break from your computer. Get something that you can practice your balance on. I'm going to do this. I religiously do it. It's so important for you to feel confident you can keep your balance. Your whole psyche changes. Like, for instance, when I had this bad knee, I couldn't balance well. And I lost my confidence. When the knee got better, I was able to then get my balance back, and suddenly my whole psyche changed. And I said, oh my gosh, I'm back to feeling agile again without even hardly thinking about it. It's easy. So a sudden flip of confidence, like, I've got, this will happen for you, is you'll suddenly get this surge of confidence, like, wow, I have way better balance than I thought I did, and I used to. My balance is, I can even do it on one foot. This morning I was doing leg raises, one leg raising the other, you know, standing on one leg, and I was able to do it, whereas before I couldn't do that. Couldn't do it very well, because I was going to tell you the secret before we end of balance. Another secret is, no matter what that leg that's up in the air, let's say you're standing on one leg. I do that a lot. At a grocery store, wherever I am, I stand on one leg a lot. It's really helpful. Most people don't even notice I'm on one leg. And the key is no matter what the leg up in the air is doing, don't pay any attention to it at all. Doesn't matter what it's doing. Put all your attention on the leg that's on the ground and that foot that's on the ground, and keep your attention riveted on that. And it's amazing the difference what happens. It's a miracle. When your attention is on the leg that's up in the air moving around, you're going to lose your balance. But as soon as you commit to putting your attention just on the leg that's on the ground, this is my one leg, this is what I stand on, and this is where my attention is. This other leg doesn't even belong to me. Like, it doesn't matter what's happening. It's amazing. You gain stability, and you don't lose your balance, and you don't fall. No matter what the other leg's doing, it's going to be flying all over the place. You still don't lose your balance. It's astonishing. It's astonishing. So that mental shift there makes a tremendous difference. What you're going to do with what you got, you've got the one leg on the ground. That's where your balance is. It's not on the leg that's flying around. Don't try to get balance with that leg. Keep your balance over that one leg on the ground, and keep focused on that. And somehow, it stabilizes you to an amazing extent. So that's a great trick of balance. And the other one is shifting your balance. Like, if you're on something that's rocking and moving, it's shifted back and forth, not just forward and backwards. I mean, foreside and backside, but front side and rear side. Keep shifting your rear, front and rear side, instead of backside and foreside. Okay, I mean, foreside would be like going forward like this direction. You're standing sideways on something, and backside would be the back. Like imagine you're standing on a skateboard. The foreside would be what your head is facing towards, and the backside's a bit away from that. Your back towards your back, and then the front side is actually then 90 degree angle going towards like the direction you're skating in, and then the rear side is the direction you're skating away from. So you have four different directions there. You call it front side, foreside, rear side, backside, something like that. Or you could switch the two. You could foreside is the front, foreside, front side, rear side, backside, foreside, front side, rear side, backside. So make sure your balance is taken, using all of that, plus going onto one foot, lifting your weight off of one foot. If you start losing your balance on a foot, lift it up and get your tension on the foot that's stable, you know, like that. All of that helps you start gaining some John balance, which is really helpful. Really helpful, because that confidence then will resonate throughout your whole life. It really does resonate. It really does. Okay, so I'm going to go heat this knee up, because it's starting. I keep treating it with heat, 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 And it's getting better. Today it started getting a little cranky, but it's getting better and better and better. I want it to get better. I want it to get better. I need it to get better. I need my swagger back. I need my that humble swagger back to, so we can keep really, really pushing it, pushing it, pushing it here going forward, really, really strongly, strongly, okay? It's got to be brisk, gradual but brisk, gradual but brisk. That is all important. Because the big waves are coming in, okay? You know the swell's coming. The buoys have shown the swell's coming. Here comes the swell. In the world, when Trump starts really boom, 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 doing his thing, his sort of brutish thing. Not saying that that's bad or good. I'm just saying that's the style. Stuff's gonna happen fast. He gets stuff done. He pushes stuff. He's going to really shake it up, and it's going to send shockwaves around the planet. People are going to get agitated. People are going to be polarized, and they say, "Well, we should. What should we do? Should we go into mental illness or brutality?" And they'll be fighting over these crumbs of nothingness, really. And we want to be able to just be in this peaceful harbor, just chilling out, doing our balance exercises. And wowing, or hum being humble, or humble swagger of just, being in the wow. I'm shocked right now. And most of the day, I'm shocked. Most of the days of my life, I've just been in shock by how tremendous, my blessings are, actually. That's what we want our life to be like. And when we live life like that, guess what? It's our final go-round in the realms of brutality and mental illness. It's our final go-round. Okay. We're not, we then are the Dharma. Okay, we are the Dharma then at that point. And we are the abidance. We're just directly experiencing it. We as the experience it with the isness of the experiencing. That's all there is. That'll that's it. For and so we no more, sojourns in the land, the realms of insanity. Unless, it's like someone like Ram Maharshi coming in, which is, occasionally that happens because out of great compassion, they're able to do that. It's extraordinary. But, okay, so live a life, a humble life of true humility, and don't be shocked over the shock. Accept it. Say, okay, I'm shocked. Great. Won't be the life of the party today. Great. And you stay smooth. Just, how do I describe this? Just wow. No panic. You don't, the panic doesn't get into any deepness, and you don't fixate. You do not fixate. And then brisk, brisk progress is made. Okay.